Thank you, Asni, and thank you, all our members who are joining us today. Together, as we worship, we are learning and growing in God's grace and knowledge. So a very good morning to you all, brethren. And can we just bow our heads and ask for God's blessings? Gracious Father, our loving Father in heaven, Lord, we bow, Father, our heads at this moment, and we just want to ask your mercies, Lord. Today, Lord, we are going to touch on a subject that is so vast, so sweeping and all-encompassing. Lord, we ask your mercies and help, Father. Lord, open our hearts and our minds and give us a good understanding of your word. And may your word, Lord, sink deep into our hearts and recesses and make it a part and parcel of us, Father, so that we are able to grow into a deeper and a stronger relationship with you day by day. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we ask all this. Amen. Okay, brethren, without much ado, let's begin our message right away. I thought we can take a few questions. I thought I will do a little bit of quiz program, but I won't bother you. I will take three simple questions. Okay, here's the first question. The most grandest question that is ever asked is, what is God's overall purpose for this world? Okay, what I want you to do is, please tell me which scriptural passage or which book deals with this. A second question that I have for you is, God's bounteous showers of blessings, where do we find this? Which scriptural text or which book of the Bible? And finally, the gospel in microcosm. Where do you have this picture? Which text or which book of the Bible? We could go ahead and ask more questions, but I leave it at that. The answers to all the three questions are the same. The book we are dealing with is the book of Ephesians, the letter to the Christians at Ephesia. And the particular text is chapter 1, verses 3 to 14. Before we begin, let me give you a little bit of background picture. Paul writes this letter in around AD 60. He wrote this on the heels of his earlier letter, the letter to the church at Colossians. And so this is the second letter. This particular letter is known as the Queen of Epistles because a number of reasons. You see, here we have a compressed picture of our faith from before creation and on into eternity. We have a compressed picture. And then this picture this particular scripture is loaded with rich meaning. There are a lot of themes, theological themes. And then, it is called as the Queen of Epistles. Ephesians chapter 1, verses 3 to 14, that was read to us by Asni. Okay, let's move into the text. The verse 3 says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in heavenly places. Brethren, the Apostle Paul is making two fundamental facts plain. We need to understand this fact. Here is a fact one. Paul is saying we are blessed in Christ. And because of that, we bless God our Father. And the second fact that he points out to us is about the spiritual blessings. God has blessed us with every spiritual blessings in heavenly places. Brethren, it is absolutely important that we understand these facts. These facts are important. They are vitally important. They are what I should say, significant. They are incredibly significant. Now, what Paul does in the following verses 4 to 14 onwards, is he begins to explain these two fundamental facts for us. And how does he do that? He takes a look into the past, and then he takes a look at the present, and then he takes a look into the future. So he takes a glimpse at the past. We have in the past the great choice that God made before time, before creation. And then coming to the present, we see the great plan to bring the kingdom of the God's kingdom into this world. And then look into the future, we understand the great inheritance of the redeemed universe that you and I will enjoy as redeemed people. So Paul's story restates our faith and connects us to the great epic in a way that speaks to our day as well as to his. Okay, let's move into the first aspect, the past. Verses 4 and 5 reads, even as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before him. In love, he predestined us for adoption to himself as sons through Jesus Christ. Brethren, we have a beautiful picture. The Apostle Paul is telling the choice was made. Who made the choice? God the Father made a choice. The choice was made before the foundation of the world, before the creation itself. This is what is called as metaphysics of the story. This is the deep narrative behind it. The story of your salvation and my salvation, the salvation of everyone who has ever lived or who is living or who will ever live, starts with God's choice because of God's love. From humanity, God chose the nation of Israel. From this one particular nation, Israel, he chose one lineage. And from that one lineage, he chose one family. And from that one family, he chose the womb of a teenager girl. And through her came to us himself. The story of salvation is not a mess of false starts and plan Bs. It is not giving us law and then everything going haywire. Brethren, God's choice ran through it all, telling the story with intention and love before the world began. But why would God do this? Why did he make this choice and decided to save man, knowing the loss and the pain, the trauma and the tragedy that all of us will face? Brethren, verses 4-6 answers the question. In love, he predestined us for adoption to himself as sons through Jesus Christ, according to the purpose of his will, to the praise of his glorious grace. Brethren, it is important that we understand these words and phrases. In love, his will, to the promise of his glorious grace. Nowhere does the scripture says that God chose us because we were the best and the brightest. We were not the most lovable or the most righteous. Nor does it say that God needs us for his plan to come to be put into operation. No, God did not choose us because of who we are, but God chose us because of who he is. Because of his love, his will, his glory, these things will never change. He loves us because he loves to love. He makes us worthy of his love. We don't achieve that worth somehow, and we never lose it. And so that is a picture of what happened in the what happened in the past. Let's move to the present. Verses 7-10. It says, in him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of his grace, which he lavished upon us in all wisdom and insight, making known to us the mystery of his will, according to his purpose, which he set forth in Christ as a plan for the fullness of time to unite all things in him, through things in heaven and things on the earth. The present is where we see the rising action. Brethren, what Paul is doing is, he's bringing us from the past, God's loving choice of us, to the present. God's plan to transform the world in the here and now, with us joining him in participation with him. Through all these words of hope, Paul describes us as caught up in the work and the will of God. He picks up the theme several times in this one epistle, chapter, verse 2 and 10. We see, for we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. Brethren, you and I have been created in Christ Jesus for good works. There is nothing here that says about pleasing God or earning his favor through these works. These works are an invitation for you and for me to join in his work in the world. We were created in Christ to do good works before the world began. Brethren, God's kingdom is breaking into the world, and we are called to be participants. We are called to be part of that work, not because he needs us, because he wants us, and he wants us to experience the joy and the happiness in participating in what he is doing, so that what he does means for the kingdom. There is a very nice interesting incident told in the life of Martin Luther. I mean, a man came to Martin Luther and he said, Pastor, I have become a Christian. What should I do? The pastor told him, what do you do for your living? He said, I am a cobbler. Then he said, go and make quality shoes and sell it at reasonable and fair price to the glory of God. Brethren, the kingdom of God comes in inches, not in miles. Living and working to the glory of God. Do you and I do that? Do we treat those we come across in our lives, in our neighborhood, in our colony, on the job, with grace and love? This is how the kingdom appears, rather than dramatic crescendos. The good work that God has prepared for us will range from the exciting to the ordinary, but let's not discount the acts of obedience. This is the plan we see in verse 10, the present being a part of the story. Let's move on to the third aspect and a peep into the future. The verses are from 11 to 14. Now, actually, the verses from 3 to 14 in Greek, when Paul wrote it, was one long paragraph. It was one long sentence. In one long sentence, this is the gospel in microcosm. And the ending of the story points to the future. The ride-off into sunset here is actually into the sunrise. I will just run through it. In him we have obtained an inheritance, having been predestined according to his purpose of him, who works all things according to his counsel of his will, so that we who are the first to hope in Christ might be the praise of his glory. In him you do, when you heard, you also, when you heard the word of the truth, the gospel of your salvation, and believed in him, were sealed with the promise of the Holy Spirit, who is the guarantee of our inheritance until we acquire possession of it to the praise of his glory. Brethren, it's a beautiful picture. It talks about an inheritance that you and I will receive. And the word is uses is twice. In the ancient world, inheritance means you inherit a property or a business or both, and you're not supposed to sell it. You're supposed to move into and not supposed to move into a different lifestyle. You inherited a legacy, the property and life, and you are meant to carry on. This is the kind of inheritance Paul talks about here. One of the main issues that modern Christians face and is the concept of going to heaven. Nowhere in the Bible, brethren, does it ever say that you and I are going to heaven. Our ultimate hope is not in some far-off place where we will leave this world behind. Our hope is in the new heavens and the new earths, as described in Revelation 21. Our ultimate hope is this world right here, resurrected under the rightful rule of our Lord. This world, because of sin, is corrupted. However, God did not intend to destroy this world. He decided to resurrect it, just as Jesus' post-Easter body, the resurrected earth, will incorporate the earth somehow. God's dimension and our dimension will be reunited at last. We will have the union of the temporal and the permanent, the temporal and the eternal, the mortal and the immortal, the visible and the invisible. That, brethren, is our inheritance. This is our true, and herein is our true identity as the resurrected royalty of new heavens and new earth. Our past, which began before Abraham, connects us with the present, where the kingdom breaks into the world by the power of the Spirit. Our future is coming together, is the coming together of our universe and God's dimension completely. In verses 9 to 10, Paul puts it beautifully. making known the mystery of his will according to his purpose, which he set forth in Christ as a plan for the fullness of time to unite all things in heaven and things on earth, to unite all things in him. Jesus, brethren, is the linchpin, the centerpiece that brings the whole story and all the universe together. The human story shattered at the Tower of Babel and many other places is brought back together in Christ. Brethren, in Christ, the world and the universe are united. The physical and the spiritual are united. And so, if you look at what Paul is writing, Paul writes of three things. He writes of the choice that God made. He talks about the God's plan. He talks about the inherit God's inheritance for you and for me. This, brethren, is the gospel story, the past, the present, and the future of the human story. What looks like a wandering, disparate stories is one long epic. You feel like royalty because you are. And this grand story feels familiar because it's yours and mine. And so, brethren, as we close this story, let's ask ourselves, what are the lessons that we can learn? Well, this particular passage is loaded with rich themes. The themes are huge. Not only will you require one sermon, it will require one book, a voluminous book, to expand on each scene. But I would like to bring home one simple and solid lesson that you and I can learn, and that is God's amazing grace and his great love for you and for me. Brethren, salvation is a free gift. It's a free gift of God in Christ and through Christ. But God's amazing grace, his amazing love for you and me brings this salvation about. So what we are trying to say is, you see, our salvation is a result of God's grace and his love for you and for me. There can be no better example that I can share with you than the writer of this particular epistle. Remember the Apostle Paul? One day when he was going, a blinding light struck him on the road, and he heard a voice from heaven, and that stopped him in his tracks, and everything changed for him. Life changed for him completely and fully. Brethren, the one he encountered was the name which Paul was trying to destroy. Paul, the fanatical preacher, Saul, the fanatical preacher, became Paul, the apostle of the Christian doctrine, the doctrine of grace. Brethren, what a beautiful example. Brethren, Paul saw God's amazing grace firsthand on the road. And it was a tremendous shattering event that changed his life. Brethren, because of God's grace and love, brethren, he progressed from a fanatical teacher to an apostle of Christ. Brethren, what a beautiful message. What we are trying to say is grace and love. God gives salvation through his grace and through his love. And when we say grace and love, it brings a host of concepts of realities into operation. We see that there is predestination. Then we see that there is creation. Then we will see that there is incarnation. Then we see that is redemption. Then we see there is justification. Then we see there is glorification. And finally, we see there is sanctification, and then there is glorification. So God's grace, brethren, is something that God gives freely. God's love is something that he gives freely to you and to me. And he includes you and me in the triune circle of the Father and Son and Spirit for all eternity. Brethren, do you and I face a discouragement in life? Do we sometimes, Nare, are puzzled? What's happening all around? I can't make sense of it. Do you and I struggle? Brethren, if this is the case, may I encourage you, brethren, to go and read Ephesians, this beautiful short letter, and gives you hope and gives you encouragement. It gives you peace and it gives you joy and it brings you jubilation. Brethren, God's grace and love, you will discover it for yourself in this particular letter. The Apostle Paul is the only biblical writer that uses the word grace and love so oftentimes. Brethren, do you and I face difficulties in life? Do you face, is life an uphill task? Is it a puzzle? Then please read this letter to the book of Ephesians. You'll find God's amazing grace and amazing love. Because God's grace and love are multicolored and they are multidimensional, both in meaning and in application for man and for you and for me.